God, for the life that you live in and through us, for the life that we find in one another and in you, we give great thanks. Amen.
Amen.
The thoughts today, one of the questions in the gospel today, if you have been at nine, if you haven't been there yet, what are you doing here? Sort of question. And that's really what this morning is about. What are we doing here? What are we about? What are we about as a community? And as we have mentioned, part of what fueled got us to this point was when in the annual meeting last year, Jack mentioned in his report that we need some one-time money to balance 2015, and saw that to be responsible to that, we needed to begin work leading the finance investment beginning of the year, not wait till next fall, this fall, and say, oh gosh, I wonder how it's going to be here. Let's see how things are. But did some intentional work looking at what is the life of this community? How is it reflected in the budget? And what do we see in the expenses and income that speaks to us about our life? And how might we see ourselves living in 2016? And how is it that we see ourselves participating and supporting that? And so one of the things that you have seen, I'll just put this into your hands, a narrative budget. We're certainly not the first group to have done that, but it's a way of saying, what's the flesh and blood on these numbers? What do they mean? We have said before that budgets are moral documents. They speak about what we believe and who we are and what we want to be. And so in addition to some numbers that Jack will be giving you a little bit later, this is a way for us to think about what is the bread, what is the wine, what is the flesh, what is the incarnation that all of these areas represent? Why do we do them? Why do we have these different areas in the budget, and why do we support them? Another reason we're doing this today is some feedback we received last year and some in prior years, that because we don't often talk about the budget regularly throughout the year, and because, and there's a reason for that, we don't want to just be bombarded all the time. And as things seem to be cooking along and you see buildings being attended to and stuff, some folks have said, well, we really didn't know that you needed anything from us. You seem to be doing fine. And we thought, well, okay, we'll take that feedback. We don't want to bombard, but perhaps we're doing too little of the job of communicating what it takes to make things happen here. And that then you get kind of a condensed thing in December where we say, you know, thank you for your pledges, but we're kind of in this place. Folks said it would have been helpful if we'd heard that ahead of time. So we're trying something different. We're trying, before we get into the stewardship pledge season, to get some information out about where do we see ourselves in the coming year, and what do we see it taking to do that, and to be the life that we're finding in our midst. Some of the things that you'll see here, I'm going to name just briefly, and then Millie is going to be talking, and Don Cole, and then Jack. Part of this work of the vestry in finance is examining areas. What are the areas that you see here? Why is our worship life important to us? Why is it that we gather, not just on Sundays, but have opportunities through the week for prayer and gathering and reflection? Why do we say we're a Eucharistically centered community? What does that mean? And what does it take to do that? What does it take to engender imagination and creativity and a deep sense of the sacred? What is that worship all about? Why is that so important to us? What about the kind of formative experiences that we see reflected in here? Things like young people going to Cuba. Why is that important for us to make that happen, for them to experience that? What is it that we think speaks to them, changes them, both the young people and the adults? Not just youth pilgrimages, but one of the areas that you've seen in this narrative that we have been pushing over recent years is the area of attention, both staff-wise and otherwise, to our catechesis program. Why is it that this Montessori-based, if you will, program that teaches kids to wonder, whose formative question is, I wonder why God? Why is it important for them to hear that again and again, and to wrestle with those parables, and to realize, the old cliche, they're not the church of the future, they're us now. And how do we only unleash in them, how do we unleash in our young people, our adolescents, the notion that they are adults now, not just someone who has a little less understanding and experience offered of God to be. What does it take? And that's part of why we have been focusing on that and paying attention both in terms of staff and the kind of things we make available to the young people. So if they're hearing you are the body of Christ. You see in this comments about pastoral presence, one of the things that we love about this place is being connected. And that's not just clergy presence in times of transitions. One of the things that Thomas and a number of lay people that you may know in the last couple of years have created a lay pastoral care team that meets every Thursday so that our folks who are either shut in or perhaps borderline shut in are being seen regularly. So that we are fomenting the reality that it's not just the callers who do pastoral care, that, you know, we are the body of Christ and if we really mean that, yes, we're Episcopalians. Yes, we have ordained people. But how are all of us pastors? And how do we do proactive pastoral care, not just wait until someone's in a time of crisis? How are we trying to see ahead? And so that's part of the energy for us addressing that. I appreciate that about 5 years ago, Carla, when she was on the Best Peter Number of People Outreach, said, you know, we, for a number of years, have kind of sworn our budget because things like buildings and staffing and stuff and to try to catch up with some areas that we've been neglecting. We also pull back on how much of our percentage of outreach goes to the community, how much of our budget goes to outreach, and put us in a steady path of increasing that so that our percentage of what we're giving out is much higher than it was 3, 4, 5 years ago. That's part of the budget, but that's not just numbers, it's connection. It's children first, it's rooted in the end. It's all of those projects that are helping us to know the community better, to engage with the community better, to get involved in the community better, and to understand that connectivity. So it's not just increasing the grants, it's helping us to be connected with agencies that we might not have, ever not even had that grant experience. How do we keep pushing ourselves to be in relationship with all human beings in our community? Another thing that we have changed the culture over years, and this is something that you've heard me say before, that someone in the National Church told me about 7 years ago that 80% of Episcopal churches are about 15 years behind in deferred maintenance. We're in a large club. And fortunately, your vestry a dozen or so years ago, and vestry since, have realized we can't just let that be. We can't just let these buildings and say Jesus will take care of it someday, meaning another generation someday. And as you've heard us say, we're the generation that kind of got caught appreciating that we're not going to pass that out. We're not unique. It's what lots of churches do. And so there has been a lot of energy and funds, both in terms of big projects, but also in young people. How is it that we make sure that our resources are used in a way so that any time of the week that you come here, when you see groups, they come to a place that looks like it's cared for. You know, what is it, Pauly's Island, it says, what is it, nicely shabby, or whatever they call about it? Arrogantly shabby. Someone's saying, you know, we're not even arrogantly shabby, we're just kind of shabby. And one of the things I love most, because if you talk to David, or the people who do buildings and grounds around here, and how many groups come through this building every week, one of my favorite things is to come out and go to my car, go home at night, and see some group that I don't even know who they are. You know? And I see them going down and say, man, I don't know who's here tonight. That's great, because that means there are so many that we're a part of the even keeping up with. Who are all these people that are using these buildings? And how does the present community experience the hospitality of God in a place that says this is cared for? The lawn rangers and the weed. Lay leaders, people that, you know, they're great names. But it says to every group that comes up here at night, this is a place that cares about you and has prepared a place for you. And we can look down the road at future generations and say, we did the best we could to hand you something that was loved and cared for. And something that is an outward and visible sign of how we have been cared for in this place and what we have received from this place. We're not just going to be taking, we're going to also that we're caring for. You've got to take care of yourself before you can love your neighbor. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. That's Jesus, that's not me. So, here we are, and we're looking at areas of life, and what I would like to do is to consider that, the ways we've been pushing ourselves, but also to hear, not just from me, but as I mentioned, from Millie, and then Don, and Jack, about what is some of this meaning. So, Millie, if you would talk some, tell us about Kairos.
Good morning. So, many of you, well, I'll just ask this, how many of you have really heard about Kairos West Community Center? Yay! And how many of you have actually been there? Yay! So part of what I want to do today is also just to invite all of you to come and see that space and be in that space. But I want to tell you just a little bit about how our budget is going to support that space and just to say thank you. Several years ago, the National Church said, after some study and some reflection, I think we need to stop saying, why are people not coming to church? Nobody's coming to church. And we need to start saying, how do we go to the people? Because when we go to the people, we're inviting, and the people are all of us. But when we step out of the buildings, that is the best invitation we can give to people to come in. So they set aside quite a bit of money to put into outreach and ministries that are a little different, to take some risk, which is wonderful. And so Kairos West is one of the places that got some of that money. And Todd and All Souls said to me, thank goodness, after I got back from Cuba and felt very inspired to start this, yes, do this. It was a series of people willing to say yes to a risk. The bishop, everyone here at All Souls, and myself, and a lot of community people who wanted to help us do this. So, Kairos West is a building in the middle of West Asheville. If you know a lot or even a little about West Asheville, it's completely changed, as has Asheville in general. But West Asheville used to be a very poor community, and then a lot of people found out about the Admiral. sure that we keep rolling, and to invite other people into that ministry. And so that is what we're about. That is what we're doing. During the day, when people aren't just having groups there, we also just have the doors open, and we have people come and volunteer. Kathy is now one of our volunteers. Thank you so much. And the volunteers just come in and make coffee and set out pastries and invite people in, and they do their own work while they're there. They're writers. We have art supplies, things to don. We have so many opportunities to just be and be creative together, musical instruments. And then when someone comes in, it's just simply a matter of welcoming them and listening to their story. So we do have a lot of folks on the margins who don't have places to go during the day and who've been kicked out of every other center that there is and who certainly don't have money for a cup of coffee. Right now, we have a woman who actually lives in our parking lot and sleeps on the floor of the parking lot on a box with a wool blanket that she keeps in her backpack. She's 45 years old. She's been homeless off and on since she was 16. She's an amazing writer. She's absolutely brilliant. And she comes in every morning, washes her hair in the sink, gets cleaned up, and then hosts the space almost all day. And that for her, and she uses our computer. So she gets something out of that. She's hosting, but she's also able to use the computer to send emails to people that otherwise she wouldn't be able to communicate with. And it just keeps her connected. And I think on some level, you know, we have groups come in, Asheville Youth Mission will come and serve free food, give out free food, and she'll tell them about Kairos. She is able to communicate that mission and is so useful to the space that I think it's helping her in that way as well, and it certainly helps us. So we have lots of different stories like that. I would love to continue to tell you stories about Kairos West, but I know our time is limited. So what I will do is just invite you, one, to pray for us, to pray for me that I am able to see clearly what it is that God is calling us to do in this world, and keep us on that track, and invite you to come and be in the space, to host the space if you would like to, or if you're one of those people who has a burning passion for something and you haven't been quite sure where to do it, West Asheville is a great place, and Kairos West would invite you to do that. And lastly, I just want to say thank you for saying yes to this, because each one of you in this room has done that, whether you know it or not. You said yes to this new ministry and to me as a new minister, and I really am so grateful for All Souls and for your all's ability to do that. So thank you very much.
Children and education, and social justice issues. Funding for outreach comes from Play the Pledge, from our endowment, and also from the food booth. And many of you, as you know, participate and make that possible. Food booth generates about $20,000 of income that we are in turn able to give away. As Todd said, we have increased our giving for outreach, and our long-term goal is 10% of Play the Pledge to be able to give away. Currently, we're about 6.5%. In 2014, we gave away $56,250 in grants and other gifts. In 2015, our budget is $54,491, so a little reduction because our budget reduced. In 2016, we look forward to seeing what it will be. Our grant application process this year just closed last week. We had 16 applicants requesting roughly $68,000. So as I said earlier, the need is great. We start our due diligence tomorrow, and what I mean by due diligence is we take each one of these applications, we go through it, we look at the board, we look at their financials, we sometimes go on site, we call and interview the executive director or the person who submitted the grant, and then we come back and decide uh, based on some criteria, based on All Souls' mission and vision and values, how that racks and stacks, and then we award the grants, and we do that in our sacred service on November 15th, typically every year. It's part of our process to make sure that we don't lose our centeredness in worship and how we do that. So I thought without, I would just read to you the 16 grants by title, agency, and what they want to use the money for you to get some indication of the need in our community and what people are looking for. Art for Life, music education for pediatric patients, guardian ad litem, school clothes, supplies, diapers, formula, Read to Succeed, reading coach intensive training, Wheels for Hope, a new one, refurbishes donated cars and makes them available for economically vulnerable people who need them. Our Voice, about 24 girls and members, innovative after-school program, bringing rock climbing opportunities and other opportunities. Heart of Horse Sense, year-round programming for use from Pisgah View, Deer View, and Woodbridge housing developments. Aurora Studio and Gallery, support to 28 artists in recovery. Children First, supports children learning centers in two low-income housing communities at Ellen Elementary School in West Asheville. Girls on the Run, provide 10 girls in grades 3-8 with a gift certificate to buy materials for their service project, a practice 5K, and an end of season celebration. Casting for Hope, support for women with ovarian and gynecological cancer. Calvary Episcopal Food Church Pantry, it provides a purchase of food and personal care items for people in North Henderson and Buncombe County who are experiencing financial hardship. Homeward Bound, A-Hope and Room at the Inn. And as you know, we're one of the communities that supports A-Hope, and they meet here at least 3 or 4 times a year. Room at the Inn is shelter for women, and lots of you here participate in that as well. Mountain Area Reading Service provides, their request is to provide training for volunteers and day managers for their broadcast. And Alex is here, and she's on the board there. This is an agency where there's not a single paid person that does this ministry to the community. And it's for Hispanics, for Blacks, for people who can't hear and have no other way of getting news. It's an incredible ministry. Loving Food Resources provides food and care items for people living with HIV and AIDS and those in home hospice care. Open Doors of Asheville supports building language gap program, raising the level of students growing up in poverty. And last but not least, the Haverty Congregation. Reverend Brian Combs was here, as you remember, last week or so. And they have requested a grant to purchase a walk-in freezer to support Welcome Table. Welcome Table is their ministry, which provides 350 to 500 made-from-scratch meals every Wednesday of every week. They're looking to expand their program to Sundays to provide a weekend meal as well as a midweek meal. And their grant is to request support services and a refrigerator and freezer to do that. So in closing, I would just like to say thank you on behalf of the Outreach Commission. We're honored to serve in this ministry on your behalf.
Shoulders this. Cathedral, also at the top, and budget summary. There's also a blue one, we'll get to that in a moment. There's a green one and a blue one. So there are a couple things to summarize that ties to what Tom was saying, as well as Millie and Don. And that is that as we look at this sheet, the columns represent how we did in 2014, the actual. 2015 is the year we're in. And as you were hearing, we had to reduce a few things in 2015. And we were able to, with the best reason of prayerful consideration, find about $30,000 of really one-time money that helped us balance it and keep some things in place. I think you see that there's a line that says other income up at the top. And as it goes across, you see it's 150, 159, and then drops to 131, indicating that that one-time money will not be available in the 2016. Now, there are two columns for 2016. One is sort of our guess that if we just sort of hold things together and there's not a whole lot of growth, and of course we've lost that $30,000 one-time money, we couldn't balance it. You see the $29,000. That's really close to 30. We would have trouble making that work. And that's a lot of what this exercise is about. As Todd said earlier, we've been asked a couple times about sort of at the end of the pledge campaign in a couple of years. We didn't know that you needed that, or we've already made our pledge, and now we're hearing that, you know, we're sort of short. By doing this on the front end, I think making an experiment, maybe an informed way to say, here's what we could use, and as you prayerfully consider the pledge campaign that's coming up in September and October, here's what we would use it for. And it's so exciting to hear about the things we would use it for in terms of outreach, the catechesis program in child ministry, and Kairos. Millie, I think, implied was that the national grant that we got was time limited. So being able to support that probably is something we either do and find some sort of fundraising to do for it, or we work it into and begin to support it as part of our regular budget, because it's an important part of who we are. So our last column, and the percentages that go with it, is sort of our dream, our expansion. What if we could keep going with all of the expanded outreach, that trajectory toward 10% of the budget, and supporting Kairos to a substantial amount out of the budget? What if we were able to keep all the other programs going? What if we could give staff about a 1.5% raise? They got no raises last year. All of those things together is how we built the 2016 sort of expansion budget. And what would it take to get there? Well, as you see, again on the income side, that $30,000 income one-time money is not there. We might find a little bit more to go with it. The pledges is where we would have to respond. On the blue sheet, if you can manage to balance these at the same time. These are, again, intriguing because they're graphical presentations of where our growth is going. On one side is income, and it shows really the major side of this. Pledges are 76% of our budget. I mean, we support what we do. On the other side, the expense category, also looking at places that we're hoping to have growth. And a graphing representation of what you saw with Green Chief. So the last piece for me is the other side of Green Chief that talks about pledges. And not that it's the elephant in the room to weigh us down. The pledges is where all that is going. And what would it take for us to meet the goal that we're outlining in all the expense side of the 2016 budget? What would we want to raise? What would we have as a goal? In many years, we've not really named a goal around the pledge drive. This year, I think we're trying to do that a little differently. This is what this is about in other settings, where we get to say what it is we would do with the pledge money if it comes in correctly. And there's lots of interesting information here. In the very middle of the page, sort of our goal from 2015 to 2016, we currently have 294 pledging units, individuals and families. And what if there was an increase of, say, 10, up to 304? That might be a goal for us to get to. And if our average pledge, again, there are many, many that are above and below that, but averages is a mathematical thing. You can actually do them. And what if that raised a bit? And what would $122, if you were right at the average, for any particular pledging unit translate to? It would be $10 a month for any particular person who's right at that place. And again, lots of those above and below, and you could do proportional or do your own calculation around that. And in fact, at the bottom is a handy-dandy convenient chart just to do some of that per week, per month. What would those changes do for you? And the last number I really wanted to focus on is really back up at the very top. It's the analysis around our pledges from year to year. When we get a renewal of all the pledges, we're able to tell how many increased, how many decreased, how many didn't renew, but that might be just merely they moved away or there's been a circumstance change. And then we have lots of new pledges. But the one number that's highlighted there, I think, is an important one to raise up to the whole parish. 151 pledging units just did what they did last year. And that's great. And there are many folks who are on fixed income, and we understand those things. And there are going to be many folks who really can't move the marker at all. But maybe those are the folks to talk to this year. Maybe it's the 151 to say, maybe this is your year, and oh, by the way, here's what we would do with it in terms of what our vision is around the expenses to get there. Starting to run out of time. Questions? Are we at a place where that would be useful? Lots of data to take with you. Some of this is more fun. Fun numbers. In doing the sequence differently this year, by doing the expenses in a sense first, by saying what we would do with it, we then are able to go into the pledge drive and say, here's what we're hoping to gather in. And those folks who have not been able to participate, or who haven't been regular pledgers, what an invitation it is to them. My guess is that this is the group that are the pledgers here this morning. But we can also extend that invitation to others. And if you're in the group that's been able to increase your pledge, as you prayerfully consider your pledge for 2016, this gives you some background about what it would be used for. And if you're among those who didn't make a change from last year to this, maybe looking forward to next year, this is also a year to consider an increase and think of the things that it would, that it would support. Other questions? Yeah, George.
Jeff, do I read this right in that, I just wanted to draw some conclusions, but it looks to me like if the 151 units that were the same increase about $10 a month, that it would be only our goal. Is that?
Because that average is about 2,200, yeah. That's very, very close to exactly what we're
doing. Yeah, so I think that's really helpful to conceptualize that if there's 150 families, would it, would or could increase the bucks a month from where they are?
Is this kind of information?